Cram.com.
Okay, so we're going to talk today about cell phones and text messaging. I'm just kidding. We're actually talking about the cell cycle and messaging within the cell and how it relates to current disease and treatments. For more lectures like this, please check us out at medcram.com. What I wanted to talk about kind of goes back a little bit to high school biology, but this is really cool because we're actually starting to see some of our discoveries that we've made years ago come to fruition today. So let me draw for you the cell cycle. So if you remember from high school biology, there's a cycle where the cell reproduces itself through the process of mitosis. Well, mitosis isn't the only thing that happens. It's just part of it. You remember there is prophase, metaphase, anaphase, telophase. Well, that has to do with mitosis. So this is phase M, okay? But that's kind of the last thing that happens. Usually what happens is the cell stays in either G0, so that would be the pre-synthetic phase, or it goes into G1. Now G1 is where it's preparing to divide, and the first thing that it needs to do before it does divide is it needs to replicate its DNA, and that's called the S phase. S stands for synthetic, and that's where you have chromosome duplication. It's very time consuming, very energy consuming. So once it actually reproduces its DNA, then it's then going to go into a pre-mitotic phase known as G2. And it will continue to grow until it's ready to actually go through the division process. So let's follow this around. Here you have a cell. It makes a decision to go through with dividing. It's got to reproduce all of its chromosomes, all of its DNA. Then it's got to grow some more and then finally divide. And this could keep going in the case of cancer, or it could exit and stay as a cell in G0. So what's really interesting about this is that the body regulates this pretty well normally, and there's a restriction point right here, right before the S phase, okay? So this is a restriction point. And it makes sense because you don't want to go through this. It takes a lot of energy if things are not right, okay? And this is regulated by cyclins, which are proteins that make sure that it's ready to go through with replication. So this restriction point, if it finds that it's not quite perfect or not quite ready, it will exit out of this system and you will get something called senescence. Okay? Basically, it's programmed death, which causes some inflammation. For instance, if there's oxidative stress, if there is cellular damage, and it detects that. So before it copies it, it's going to say, you know what, this cell is not ready to divide. We should not be dividing this cell. We're going to replicate errors. It's not a good idea. So it exits the cell right here before the S phase. This is called the restriction point, and it's cyclins which mediate that. Okay, now let's say everything's good and it goes through the S phase. The next thing that's going to happen is there is another checkpoint right before it goes through mitosis and actually divides. So in other words, there is another checkpoint over here, and it will look to make sure that the DNA was reproduced correctly. So if it wasn't reproduced correctly, then it'll say, you know what, we need to just involute and die, and that's called apoptosis. Now apoptosis is very important because apoptosis doesn't give inflammation, okay? But you could also get replicative senescence, which does cause inflammation. Okay, now there are a couple of other terms that you may not have heard of. One of them is autophagy. This is where the cell starts to break down itself and starts eating itself. It's like a catabolism state. Another word that you may not have heard is necroptosis. Okay, this is where the cell dies and it uses something called an RIP, which is kind of cute, rest in peace, but it's an RIP kinase. And this also can cause inflammation. Now, there's another thing called efferocytosis, and this is pretty cool because here you have phagocytosis. with leukocytes that actually eat up the trash and the cellular debris, and it reduces autoimmunity and it reduces inflammation. So that's good. Okay, so this is generally the cell cycle that we're talking about. There's a number of things that can happen to cells in the cell cycle, and the purpose of all of this is to make sure that only good cells reproduce and bad cells stop reproducing or they die. And this is to prevent cancer. When you go through this cell cycle, one of the things that happens when you do this synthetic phase is you lose something called telomeres. Telomeres are the ends at the end of the DNA. So let's say this line here was the DNA. There would be little telomeres at the end, because every single time you reproduce or duplicate a chromosome, you don't reproduce the whole thing. You get a part of it cut off. And so there is something called telomerases, which add on to the end. Well, in certain cases, you don't have these enzymes because there's mutations in them. And these enzymes are things called TERT and TERC, so TERTs and TERCs. And they found that mutations in these have been found in patients with idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis and also COPD. In fact, idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis have mutations in both TERT and TERC, whereas COPD just has mutations in TERC. So once again, we see the cellular basis here of disease. Now, the other thing I want to mention is this restriction point, and for that matter, this one too, in fact, all of this is regulated very strictly by receptors. And we're going to talk about a specific receptor called an intrinsic tyrosine kinase. This intrinsic tyrosine kinase phosphorylates enzymes, which allows transcriptors on the DNA to work. And these intrinsic tyrosine kinases can be activated by different receptors. And we're going to talk about those receptors next, because if we can eliminate the tyrosine kinase from signaling this to go through, we can potentially take cancer and arrest it in its tracks. So let's talk about that, because that's pretty important. Okay, so there's four types of receptors that we're going to talk about. There are receptors with intrinsic tyrosine kinase activity, and then we have receptors that are lacking tyrosine kinase activity. And then we have G proteins and steroid. Let's talk about these receptors with intrinsic tyrosine kinase activity. So these are receptors that directly control the entry of cells into the cell cycle. So they directly control cell cycle. You can see why this would be a target for cancer treatments. Okay. So what are the type of receptors that we're talking about? There is the epidermal growth factor. There is the platelet-derived growth factor. There is the vascular endothelial growth factor, fibrosis growth factor, and TGF-beta. So these are all receptors on the cell surface that interact directly with an intrinsic tyrosine kinase, which will directly control cell cycles. So the purpose of this is to find the receptors for all of these and to block it. And if we can block it, then potentially we can prevent cancer from forming. So the epidermal growth factor receptor can be blocked by medications, for instance, gefitinib. You'll notice that they all end in Bs. Another one is ERLOTINIB. Another one is AFATINIB. So these are all receptor blockers. Okay? Platelet-derived growth factor, VEGFR and FGFR and things of that nature. These can be blocked, at least these three right here, can be blocked by something called nintedanib. And that was FDA approved back in 2014 for the treatment of idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. so IPF, and it kind of slows down the progression. Again, this is utilizing through a tyrosine kinase receptor blocker. Now, real quick, cells that lack tyrosine kinase would be receptors like IL-2, 3, interferon gamma, and they actually use something called a JAK kinase, and then they signal to the cell using something called STATs. These are second messenger things that go into the nucleus and transcribe from there. You may recall that G proteins use GTP, and they use cyclic AMP as second messengers. And then finally, steroid hormones are steroids, of course, that kind of look like vitamin D. Kind of drawing this schematically here without spending too much time. Looks like a steroid, and it kind of cuts right through into the nucleus of the cell without any receptors, and it does transcription. Perhaps a better picture would be like something like this. Okay, so kind of like a vitamin D or cholesterol analog. Okay, so this explained a little bit about cell cycling. Let's talk about cell-mediated immunity and helper T cells and things of that nature in the next lecture.
Hi, I'm Dr. Roger Schweld. We're excited to announce the launch of MedCram.com. You know, over the past 4 years, we've produced top quality videos explaining concepts in medicine clearly. We've been overwhelmed by the support that we've gotten from you, and that's why we want to take medical education to the next level at MedCram.com. We now have high yield and comprehensive review courses on cardiology, pulmonology, hematology, and infectious disease, with more to come. Join us at MedCram.com.